Есть две базовые линии обсуждения, которые сегодня хотелось бы услышать.
So, about today's discussions. First of all, we would like to discuss how startups and our clients see the services of technoparks. What do they expect? And how those collective users centers already show themselves in this activity. What is the essence of their activities? What are advantages and disadvantages? And now a couple of words as to why this topic is very important for us. As you know, Technopark is developing right now. You probably know that in August we are going to move to the new premises of Technopark. Startups will also move there, and partly collective users center will move there as well. And more changes are coming, more important changes. That field right behind your back will be taken by a big technopark. There will be a big park there, so this is a very important and relevant topic to us right now. We talk a lot with startups, with various people. We ask them how we can organize and use all the possibilities and opportunities that Skalka will provide to us in the most efficient way in order to provide the necessary technical support. What services we need, whether these services will be or need to be free, or they need to be provided with grants. Then whether technoparks and collective user center will be certain self-regulating organization, and they will work according to orders, or what model they will use. So that is what we are here to discuss. And now I would like to introduce you to our panelists, to the participants of our round table. Evgeny Getz is a person very well known in Skalkovo. He represents a beautiful technopark, Kridby. It is an accredited common user center. And there are two more city building enterprises, ESS, and another enterprise. Well, Evgeny will tell us more about his experience. To the right from me, Sergey Hakhanov from SMA Center. Again, you all know him very well. He manages a microanalysis laboratory that operates within Collective Use Center. Then he's followed by Oleg Chutko. He's a new element of our team. He represents his company that is very experienced in educating and implementing new technologies, and it is very experienced in working with students and startups. Prototyping Center, Boris Saprykin. Boris represents our 3D prototype team, again, very well known to you. And they do a lot. They present their work on the ground floor. There, within that team, we produce new elements, new products. And this 3D prototyping is being developed actively. We try to include and enrich it with new prototypes, so we would like to get your point of view on that. And finally, last but not least, Viktor Karavaev, fine engineer. It is fine mechanics providing films, so they are based in Zelenograd. And now I would like to start with defining what is a collective user center, as this notion can be interpreted in various ways. And now I ask our participants to take 1 minute and tell us what is their opinion on that. Collective user center, just by looking at this name, this is a place where people are have an opportunity to use some property altogether, some equipment. But is it possible to do that in terms of modern equipment, considering all the complexity of the process of using this equipment? Probably no. That is why the current definition of collective use center, this is a way to provide services to everyone at once. And the people that are consuming these services, they get it at a price lower than the market one. So I think that these collective user center can be defined as that. Okay, thank you, Sergey. I represent collective user center. Microanalysis is the name, and our center provides our customers with the R&D services, and we try to make our services as affordable, as convenient and accessible as possible. The education that we provide for our experts is of high quality and very expensive. You can use the equipment that we provide according to the conditions of the agreements and using the methods that we set out. So, Oleg, from our point of view, collective user center, it is a structure that needs to provide not only the services of leasing equipment or renting equipment, but also some services of assisting with R&Ds. So it's a place where a person with an idea can come and try to implement this idea in the form of a prototype, pilot project, and then proceed with the small series stage. Well, I agree to my colleagues that the center is a place where the participants of the fund can come and be provided with certain services that can implement their ideas there. And we are there to help them, to assist them with their innovative incentives and projects. We provide the equipment that they cannot afford sometimes. And we help them to provide services with certain discounts and at better conditions that's on the market. In our organization, Collective User Center provides engineering services as well, as no innovation breakthrough is possible without engineering innovations and in creating a model or prototype, a sample that is ready to serial production is impossible without engineering support. We provide assistance with calculation, with engineering consulting, and in our company, Collective User Center provides high quality services at price that are affordable for startups. So every startup can involve us, can be assisted by us at any stage without hiring expensive experts. Well, dear colleagues, as far as I understand, please, Vadim. Sorry, I haven't introduced you another very good colleague of ours. He's a representative of Tech Home Group. He's a participant in our collective user center. Vadim, the floor is yours. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. I support Andrei and other colleagues. Has been not long time ago that we help innovative projects. We provided a computer block with the control system and battery. It is a satellite that will soon be launched here. It has been made here in Skalkovo, and it will be launched as a Russian satellite. It was an incentive brought up by Andrei Roman and his colleagues. What I would like to say here, when the professionals work, we provide assistance with the mechanic processing, with the processing light alloy elements and high temperature elements. According to our experience, the people here, especially the people from aerospace cluster, they are more interested in innovations themselves, but they are not familiar with the process of producing, and that is where we step in. We have already come quite a long way developing this program, and we will be assisting the projects further on. Another participant of our round table, Veniamin Khazanov. He's a founder of several startups, and also he works in our collective user center. From your point of view, well, it's it looks like we all shared this point of view, and there is no discussion. But on the other hand, it's not good not to have equipment. Sometimes you do not trust people who do something for you. So why finally you came up with this idea of collective user center? Thank you for giving me the floor. It is very symbolic for Russia to have two heads. Just remember the coat of arms of Russia. But I have experience in creating 200 medicines. Doing that job, I came to a clear idea, conclusion, that we need to do everything to save, to keep the inventor, because a brain of an inventor is very different from that of an R&D expert. And we need to exclude over-educating an inventor. We can't break his brains. We need to give them a possibility to generate ideas and implement them. But in order for him to do so, he needs a very reliable mechanism that could accept a project. But very often, an inventor cannot form a project. He can invent. And that is where he needs assistance, coaching, actually from the very beginning. And even if he is able to come up with a project, he thinks that it is a project. His inventor's brain does not take into account that there is a market, there is this pharmaceutical industry. He has no experience in working in this industry, and that is why he does all the possible mistakes. And I know almost all former pharmaceutical experts in this country. I'm a pharmaceutical expert. I am a chemist, and I've been managing a laboratory of pharmaceutical researchers created by me. And then I joined a company that started an R&D center, and very soon we will be a Skolkovo R&D center. We are based in Tomsk, but we work with other cities behind the Ural Mountains and in the European part of Russia as well. We cooperate, we communicate, and we together look at situations and try to figure out whether there is a project there and there is no project there. And very often the money is made there. We pick up a project and give the money to the producer. If we realize with an inventor that there is a project there, we give them all the possibilities. They can work at our facilities, actually. When we call it collective user center, some people laugh because pharmaceutical industry is very high tech today. Korolev never admitted anyone to his spaceships, for example, but we do. And it is pharmaceuticals is high tech in the way it is being regulated. In the US, for example, this process is very much regulated. And speaking about transferring the technology, it is very expensive to transfer the technology than to invent one. It is more difficult to transfer Maserati technology than to invent a new car. And if you want to call it collective user center, we may call it there, but that's what I think it is. And now you are free to voice your opinions. It's good if you have an opposing point of view, because then we will have a discussion. You can address any speaker, because we want to have this kind of content and interaction. And just to highlight the burning issues, I would like to ask you, speaking to an investor, speaking to business angels, for example, Alexei represents business angels here. Well, Alexei, tell us, is it important for business angels to check, to validate a technology by a collective user center?
Thank you, Andre, for giving me an opportunity to speak, to answer a question, since business angels, most of them made money not in high-tech industries. I think that without additional technical expertise, it does not make sense to invest. How can it be implemented is another issue. I recommend that you attract experts in this or other area. It is easy to do. If it's interesting for you, I'll explain you how. But as for the center of collective use, this is I don't know whether it's a functional approach. I don't know whether you have such a function here, let's say an audit or something. Well, it is useful and right way to go. My main comment is that the business angel is limited in his possibilities. It's not a fund. He has only his mind and money. Therefore, there's a lot of talk about syndicated deals, co-investments, etc., about cooperation with the funds, etc., etc. Thank you, Alexei. Is there any relevant experience in this regard? I will appreciate if you share it with us. I know a few instances when there are not many cases of the kind, but when collective use centers, one center of industrial design helped one of the participants, helped with the design to one of the members, for one of the members, and then there were 3.5 times as many members willing to participate in the project just because the design was improved. Well, moving on, I would like to ask our esteemed speakers about the following. Is there a difference between the centers of collective use in the universities that were typically set up for the training process and the centers for the startups that develop the innovative products? They are oriented on the market. They're doing it for the purpose, so they are oriented on some industrial, cost-effective technologies. So we will start with you, Evgeny. Thank you. you. As for the Center for Collective Use, not only it revolves around the equipment that can be installed at the university, of course it revolves about its human resources. So we need to understand what sort of people work at universities and what purposes do they pursue, and what kind of people are employed at the Center of Collective Use. Let's look at the Krasnoyarsk Center for Prototyping. As for industrial specialty of Krasnoyarsk, Krasnoyarsk is an industrial city. And people with the engineering competencies are oriented on the industries, mainly on high-tech industries, on space technologies, military technologies, etc. As for teaching at universities, it implies R&D centers. Therefore, the goals of people that work at those R&D centers, they are oriented on the science development. So we have a somewhat industrial approach, while those guys are focused on science and its development. We need to make sure that our product will be implemented, will have an industrial application. And therefore, startup should be focused on that. If startup is at an early stage, and it's important for the startup to validate the application of the product, yes, of course, they can use the Center of Collective Use at the university. And of course, the startups can say there is a certain potential in that. But if you need to get a prototype, I believe that you have to approach specialized centers of collective use. Thank you, Evgeny. How about you, Sergey? The main difference of our center from R&D center or a lab at the university is that we are a commercial company and we have a structure of commercial organization. Therefore, we are oriented on the client and on comfortable service, or providing comfortable service to the client in terms of meeting the deadlines, providing the quality. Because we shape the public opinion about our activities, about our results, accomplishments, competencies. And if we tarnish our reputation, we that certainly will result in losing clients, and then we won't survive on the market. Therefore, we are client or customer-oriented organization. That's our core difference. Judging on our experience using the resources of universities, at least in Russia, is somewhat complicated because you face lots of issues like who is the point of contact, who should draw a bill, an invoice, what timeline is would you have to use, because universities conduct exams, etc. And we understand that people are largely focused on scientific research, and this the main purpose of setting up those centers was to conduct research, scientific research. Therefore, I think the centers, the industrial centers that are oriented on industrial applications are a lot more suitable for the startups. Can I also specify who, let's say your clients contact you, do you discuss, what do you discuss with them, or what do you give your opinion, do you share your opinion about their business ideas? We are the B2B company, so we sell the product that is the basis for our customers to develop their own products. So we understand that by selling their own product, the customers will increase our business. Therefore, we are interested in making sure that our customers succeed. And Then we also should say that within our team has its own center in order to cater to the needs of our clients. But I should highlight that this is not just another center. It's a center that provides engineering services, or offers engineering services. Let me remind you that this a scientist is a person that develops something. For a scientist, scientists cannot think or focus on implementing the product. It would be catastrophic for a scientist to think about both factors. So we are in charge of implementation part, while the scientist can focus on development. Okay, Boris, there are lots of centers of collective use everywhere. There are mobile labs, automobile-based labs, many students are invited to use those labs to create their 3D prototype. Are they your competitors, by the way? I don't think they're competitors per se. I think as for our company and our center of collective use, we are something in between. On one hand, we are centers for young people, and at the same time, we are oriented on production as well. We actually go to schools and we show small examples of prototyping. So that's something what we do. But we actually differentiate in between two types of activities. But as for production, I would agree with my colleagues. I can say that for startups that reside here at Skolkovo, it's important to come up with a ready-to-go product that they can sell well and make it commercially successful. As for universities, they are indeed are focused on research, on training, education, so students can learn something from using the centers. And you know, they are not targeted at getting a commercially successful product, but they can get something new that will help them then implement or develop the other ideas. So one thing is an educational, supporting educational process, but as for Skolkovo startups, I think they should feed their developments with implementation phase, industrial implementation phase. But as for university labs, well, as the previous speakers said, there are some issues with practical implementation. Let's say at universities, yes, there are examination sessions for the students. So we can say that there are many issues to overcome, and we understand that the equipment that is used for scientific research might be complex and might not suit your goals, startup goals, when other centers, they have different kind of equipment that fits your needs. Once again, the equipment at the universities can be more high-tech, but it's oriented on scientific research. Victor. Well, you deal with vacuum technologies. It's a very specific area. How does it go with you? You are a commercial lab, right? We do not make money solely on our Skolkovo residents. For us, the cooperation with Tekken Park is a more marketing project. We get access to a large audience. I would like to say that unlike unlike other speakers, I don't want to advertise our lab, but I would like to talk about the specifics of other center of collective use, residence, and technopark. As for residents or startups, they typically do not have lots of money to implement the ideas, and as a rule, in terms of cooperation. Okay, moving on. So we always note that in 99% of cases, startup is startup does not underestimate the engineering part, and even with our not inexpensive fares, well, our inexpensive fares are still expensive for the startups. But we are a commercial organization. Our reputation is important for us as well as our revenues. So in this regard, I'd like to ask a question. I'd like to address a question to the management of Technopark. Are you planning any co-funding? I understand that not all startup projects that would be willing to use the Center for Collective Use, that many startups either are not willing or are not able to spend money. So do you think that the Skolkova Foundation could participate in such programs in any way? We are talking about financial support. Thank you for the question. Allow me to answer it later. There is a very important component, namely the fare. So now I'd like to hear your comment, Vadim, regarding the difference between various centers of collective use. I'd like to give my alternative vision. A lot was said about universities, and it's that we are a startup and a support of startup. So here, I think you should not fully ignore the services of institutes that institutes can offer. Let's look at Moscow Aviation University. They have special equipment for simulation, and so they have already good experience. They even take orders and they manufacture some parts. So it actually might be inexpensive for you. Another example, we have an institute named, a college named after Bauman, and Skolkovo came up with initiative of setting up a center of collective use, like a mini mission control center or simulation control center. But you don't need to do it because the Bauman University already has such a prototype. So I think in this case, you should maintain your contacts with the universities. And nowadays, universities are able to buy very expensive equipment, and sometimes their lab is not fully low. It doesn't have a great workload. So they also can provide you some simple services like putting on a layer of coating, whatever. So I think this is just an information for Technopark. Get some information from these institutes and provide this info to startups so they know what is available. Remember that technologies are expensive as well as equipment is expensive, and you see many are not able to afford such equipment, including the lab here. Therefore, we will have to use the outsourcing. So do not forget about it. You know, I would like to ask a very specific question because we've been a startup for 3 years. We are a member of Skolkova, and as all startups, we applied for the grant, and of course we did not get it, but our team continues working, and so we are looking for ways to get grants. So now we are working together with Germany, the German partner, because German partner, we have a biomed cluster. We work at the biomed clusters, so they are ready to provide us some amenities, some facilities. So considering that you work under Skolkovo brand, you are located at Skolkovo. And you see, we were able to get some money, but and now we'll be cautious spending this money. So since you work on the Skolkovo brand, maybe you could offer a certain, well, not discounts per se, but maybe you could discuss with the Skolkovo management about the following. Let's say they do not have funds for grants, but at least as for a small amount that is needed to achieve certain goals, maybe this small amount, this small cost will be compensated. Then startups will be attracted by this, because so far we hear a lot of theoretical discussions, but so far I'm not convinced that I should approach you tomorrow.
Thank you very much for your comment. I'm going to answer it as well. And but first, let us finish this round. And please consider academic institutes, because it's I think it's their profile if we compare those with the universities. And then we will speak about the rate, how much does it cost, how it is supported, what grants and other means of support we have. Thank you. My colleague, he's from Tomsk. He is from an academic institute. It is a cardiologic center in Tomsk. You said that a pharmaceutical cluster has been created in Tomsk, and I have become a head of one of the projects in this cluster recently, and there we united and integrated all the companies, institutes, manufacturing companies, industrial companies in one project. For example, in my company there is a holding with an R&D center, and there are always spin-off projects in this company. They look at all the grants, Bartnik Fund, all other support organizations, and they look where they can do this. For example, it's chemical synthesis. This process is easily implemented in our chemical university. They are the people that come to us, they are scientists. And this is the problem that you mentioned. For a scientist, I know what it is. I worked in R&D. They approach to their tasks in a different way, but we reach to that kind of agreement. If you want to integrate, then you need to allow us to create a quality management system. Our quality management system. Then when the head of the university and his deputy say that we can implement our quality management system, we can put our R&D part, R&D group there. If they need a supervisor, they use it. If no, no. But we are sure that what happens in a laboratory of a university or a research institute is done according to the quality management system that is applicable throughout the industry. Then the result is automatically included into the general domain of R&D projects. Otherwise, it will be suspended. It'll just stop and go nowhere. This is the system that we use. And this is how it works with us. Thank you for your valuable contribution. It is very interesting and very important from the point of view of methods and practices.
Another question, please.
Good afternoon. We are thinking about registering with Skolkova. We have a laboratory. And okay, speaking about your collective user center with the equipment and all the stuff, this equipment will be accessible to everyone. So any person can come and work there for 3 hours, then another come works for another 3 hours, or how it is organized. For example, there will be an organization that will operate, support, maintain the equipment, because the equipment does need maintenance. If you compare a regular scientific R&D university, I have experience in working with a medical university on the medical and technical department. And our operators there cannot easily access any person to their equipment, because for example, they understand that today they perform an experiment, and if someone touches this equipment, everything will go to scrap. And how will it be organized in your center? Well, this is a question that concerns more the techno park. I will answer you. I'd like to hear the opinions of other people, but from our point of view, well, it has already been expressed by the other speakers. The equipment is to be used by professionals. This is the key condition. However, experiments in the laboratory, we'll touch upon this topic later on if we have time. There will be a laboratory for common use. And there is a number of experts of the professionals of the operator that operates and maintains the center. As to rates, tariffs, and support, there are various types of support, means of support that Skolkova is using now. These are levying taxes. So the residents do not pay taxes according to federal law 244. There is another means of support. Do we give grants? Companies receive grants, and this year the situation has improved, because right now we give grants again, and not all the grants will be used this year even if we continue giving them out at the same rate. So please be active. This forum is for you here. As to collective user center, the current model is that we invite commercial companies and they provide services. So the rates are above zero. More than that, we discussed the topic whether we need and we can provide free services for the participants, for the residents. And there were various opinions, even among the participants, because they said that the services should not be for free, because free services are not effective. And in that respect, I think I will not inspire you, because we do not have free services in our strategy. But our strategy, there is an intention to give additional grants for collective user center. It'll be an addition to grant policy. And in this way, participants will be able to access an easy procedure. And according to our surveys that we performed among startups, well, we ask them, are you interested in this service? Yes, we are. Are you ready to pay for this? One of 10 says yes. And he is either investor or he has resources or other capabilities. Well, of course, we will try to make it as accessible as we can, but we are not going to do it for free. This is very clear to us. And I would like to ask our colleagues to share their point of view on that matter as well. What are the pros and cons of free services? What are you for, tariffs or free services? Evgeny. Well, CRITB actually implements this kind of policy. This is a regional business incubator and a prototyping center, which has been accredited by Skolkovo Center. We need it mostly to support startups. But the main purpose of CRITB as a as another organization is to help startups. And we know where to make money. We can provide subsidies for the work that our startups do. So our residents, they are given certificates for certain sums. Right now it's 100,000 ruble and rubles. This money is enough to produce a prototype using a 3D printer or another printing platform, to have something to present to an investor, to have something to test and try. So these are the changes and improvements that we plan, and it already works in our organization. Actually, I would like to ask you about providing a service in terms of a high-tech market. From that point of view, whether the service should the services be free or paid for? Well, in my point of view, free services is a demotivator. It is a demotivating aspect for both users and executors, because a free service puts no obligations on the executor, and the customer does not get the service at full scale. Even if the customer receives a service with a discount, there is more motivation there. Oleg, well, the Center of Collective Use is actually a commercial organization, and people work there for salaries. So we need to have return on investment. And if we provide our services for free, why investing into this organization? Another question is, do we have mechanisms to compensate the investment, not by taking money from the users of the service? Sometimes we can allow consumers to pay less because the regional government will be compensating certain sums for Technopark using special funds, and we have these kind of funds on the regional level and in Skolkovo as well. If there is no such mechanism, then, well, everything will be put on the shoulders of customers, and then we know the result. Another thing is that, from my point of view, startups need to assess sensibly their costs that they need to have in order to produce a project. If you want to produce their product, if you want to produce a cell phone, you need to spend some money. You need to spend the money later on the later stage. And when talking to an investor, please be sensible in assessing those costs. But how can a startup assess these costs if they have no experience in producing the product? Well, here we can go back to our discussion about business angels who are there to assess and assist startups with defining the costs they need to have. So you need to involve an expert, a person with the expertise who could provide consulting. And to say that, for example, yes, you can produce a microscope, but it's not enough to put your idea on paper. You need to invest into mechanics, optical technologies, and so on. And there is another opinion. It is not mine, but still it exists. If a startup, a company that is to become successful business-wise, if it cannot outline its business strategy and raise the money, then this company will not receive any investments. No one will want to do this, and the success is very unlikely. Well, a very good question. I would like to go back to the previous speaker. For example, if you receive a grant in Skolkovo, you get an estimate. In the estimate, there will be information about the prototype. Then you get it back to the fund. Skolkovo is not very well established yet. We still learn how to manage innovations. In the Western countries, it's much better established. Startups are poor, and in order to show something to an investor, they need to have a prototype. And that is why I think that the service is to be for free. But in order not to let people to play around with that, there needs to be a plan. They need to show something. There needs to be a plan that an investor will look at, that Skolkovo will look at. Then you filter this project, and the projects that you select will go to Technopark. And then the selected prototypes will be put into production. So I think that this idea with grants is actually great, because Skolkovo does not give enough grade. There are few. So this grant to produce a prototype, a product to demonstrate. Well, we can state that you can receive this grant only once. So you, a startup needs to think when it needs this kind of grant, an early stage or later on. But again, I would like to reiterate that these people are few, are poor, and sometimes they have brilliant projects. This, for example, a company says that this year it has been 2 years since we applied to produce a prototype, and the competitors are not waiting for us to come in. So Skolkovo has been operating for 3 years. A huge amount of work has been done, but we need to improve. We need to become more flexible, and let us not oppose one thing to another. Thank you. Before giving the floor to Veniamin, I would like to answer and say that according to my experience, everyone who works in biopharm cluster does not imagine what costs this cluster has. And the smallest research is 10 million or several millions at least. Well, when we started discussing it, how do we organize it? Do we provide a service for free, or should it be paid for? Well, the most important thing is not to mix targets with the technology. We all operate within innovative activity. We commercialize ideas. we want to make an idea that is worth nothing or has a negative value, so it takes money. First, we present it in some way that allows us to paint it. Then it gets some value. When we have a prototype, it costs even more. When there is a possibility to transfer this technology, and if the market sector is right, then you have hit the goal. It costs millions. So what is our task? We need to get into the Forbes list from the stage of an idea. And I know people who have come that way. But when you, a startup, sits with an idea that costs nothing, why business that does prototyping, that performs chemical experiments, why does this business needs to provide you with a service that will help you to go that way? Money cannot be given for nothing. Okay, the industry may be interested. If it is so, okay, it's great. The government will provide you with the money in order for you to transfer that money into your personal money, because you anyway will produce medicines that are necessary for our company. We can give you $1 million without any need to repay them. But you need to prove us that you are worth it. So I think that you need to order services for money. And Skolkovo Center provides services at a very special price, not the market price, but this is a technology. It will not be able to survive if it provides services for free. And that's how it works all over the world. Well, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Benjamin. We are wrapping up this session. We still have time for a question, Q&A session. We can do it now, and you can do it later on the fringes of the conference. Thank you very much. I would like to thank you for the words that inventors have to be taken care of in each and every way. You should need to take care of them and set up a special environment for them. Well, is there a need in the centers of collective use in the area of in the area of construction? We are not talking about some high tech areas, something like that. Let's say to test certain equipment, so that we provide an opportunity for similar startups to develop. And there is a specific question as well. Let's say there is an engineer, and such engineer has invented a combustion engine, and he's ready to manage the lab. And if you're interested in anything of the kind, I'm ready to talk in detail. Well, thank you for the opinion. What we think that not only engineers, but all inventors and managers also have to be pampered and taken care of, because they are the components of our support. As for the lab for engines or are developing engines, if there is a demand for such lab, we will set it up. As for the person who should be provided a lab, that's another issue. He should be similar to other Skolkovo members. We do not differentiate between startups and members. Come to energy efficiency cluster, and we will discuss this issue. Well, all our participants who took part in our discussion, I so fully at your service. I would like to draw some conclusions. How do we see an ideal center of collective use? So it is a center that employs experts, specialists. The experience is relevant. The experience that they have accumulated and that they can pass to other members. Of course, quality management is important so that the lab is efficient and is customer-oriented. The price or cost certainly matter because it has to go down as much as possible for so that the infrastructure, support infrastructure can develop and commercial enterprises can continue operating and developing. And of course, we need to have support tools, and I'm going to do a lot in this regard together with the grant committee in order for all this to be implemented. We are going to do it certainly together with the clusters. We understand that such labs should be located nearby. It has to be linked to the community of startups because then we will ensure the synergy effect just because experts in the in the same area can communicate. Well, I think these ideas are going to be implemented. We are open for the dialogue. I kindly ask you to leave your comments at Technopark website and we are going to implement them. Thank you. Everyone, thank you all participants of our discussion. I wish you to have a good day at here at the Startup Village, and I hope that your projects will have commercial success and you will find here technologists and investors. Thank you.